Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents To Tell the Truth, My Life as a Foreign Correspondent, by Lewis M. Simons. Foreword by the Dalai Lama. Narrated by Graham Rowat. The first mission of a newspaper is to tell the truth as nearly as the truth may be ascertained. Eugene Meyer, publisher, Washington Post. The Dalai Lama. Foreword. Journalists have an important role to educate and inform the public, as an observer and in an objective manner. That is what Lou Simons, whom I have had the opportunity to meet several times, has been practicing while covering developments in different parts of the world. His revealing book, To Tell the Truth, is a testament to his application of this approach. However, journalists, too, sometimes face a moral dilemma whether to continue remaining an observer or be involved with the subject they are covering. The author details one such experience in the book, which he related to me in one of our meetings, too. While on a reporting trip across Tibet, he found a Buddhist monk, whom he had befriended on an earlier visit, to be gravely ill. His human feelings triumphed over his journalistic need to be not involved and secured treatment that saved the monk's life. From a spiritual perspective, too, this response is appropriate because of the pure motivation behind it. August 5th, 2022. Introduction.
You mean you don't have to be here?
The baby-faced Marine blurted.
Shit, sir! You're fucking crazy!
He had a point. Unlike him, I did not have to be there. A handful of years older than he, I was a civilian. My wife was waiting for me in Saigon, a 90-minute flight away. Yet here I was, having just stumbled off the ramp of a rolling U.S. Air Force cargo plane as it disgorged weapons for him and the 6,000 or so other Marines besieged at Khe San. As I splashed into his muddy foxhole, I wondered, why am I in this godforsaken place, squatting alongside this rain-drenched kid in South Vietnam's red dirt? Am I, in fact, crazy? It was not the first time I'd wondered. Days earlier, I'd walked into the ancient, walled citadel of Wei. It, too, was under siege by North Vietnamese and Viet Cong fighters, initiating the benchmark Tet Offensive of 1968. As I neared the city's gate, thousands of terrified residents, lugging their worldly possessions, streamed past me, headed in the opposite direction. Why was I there? Then there was the day, heart thudding and sweat stinging my eyes. I followed a dozen Marines across a mined rice paddy. The man a few feet ahead of me suddenly froze. I heard a soft click, seconds before a mine exploded, blowing off both his legs, splattering him with his own blood, flesh, and bone. Brain-fogged, I watched him bleed to death. Why the hell was I there? There would be the Christmas day a few years later, when my pregnant wife came down with dengue fever and encephalitis in Malaysia while I was covering a coup d'etat in Cambodia. And when India expelled me on 5 hours' notice, forcing me to abandon her and our two little girls to the not-so-tender mercies of the Delhi police. Again, why was I there? I was there because that's what foreign correspondents do. They go places readers and viewers don't. They cover events that often put their lives in danger and strain their marriages. They spend months on investigations that lead to brick walls. Or, with luck and a good tip, may help topple an unjust government. No one does it to get rich. Only a handful ever earn more than a middle-class income. Fewer still do it to peddle a political agenda. Over time, many come to consider the work they do a mission, almost a calling. I began doing it because I found it exciting and instantly rewarding. I continued for half a century because I came to believe that what I witnessed and wrote could be important, that some was critical to citizens' decision-making as they struggled to keep democracy alive. Because I knew then, and know even more certainly now, that a free press is vital to a free people. Today, 2/3 of Americans don't believe what we write, egged on by an orange-haired snake oil pitchman who conned them into rejecting the lying press, a term he borrowed from a convicted Nazi war criminal. They distrust what they read or watch. America's free press, democracy's crown jewel, is trembling. Should it topple and shatter, the rest of our fragile system will crumble around it. That fear motivated me to write this book. It is an intimate account of hard work and personal risk, what many foreign correspondents do in the field day after day. It is my recollection of what I did for 50 years, covering and uncovering stories of death and destruction, corruption and abuse, courage and fundamental human decency. Over all those years, I wrote thousands of stories. Those I have chosen to include here are the ones that stood out in my mind. They brought influence to bear on events. They unearthed wrongdoing by individuals and governments. They helped initiate change, not least in me. These stories are bonded by an old-fashioned rule of journalism. The reporter, a witness, not a participant, doesn't express personal opinions. That principle guided me, guided most of us, until early in this century. Then the rules began to change. My parents, a butcher who went to work after 8th grade and a housewife with a high school diploma, did not raise me to forsake the security of the snug home they built, to travel to miserable places, to ask my wife and children to make unreasonable sacrifices for the sake of my chosen work. It wasn't my own ambition either. I did not grow up hoping to be a journalist, certainly not a foreign correspondent, an occupation so exotic sounding that it wouldn't have entered my thoroughly conventional thinking. It was a path I blundered onto after years of fumbling and failing. But once I found my way, I never turned back, never wandered. I gave journalism everything I had, and it gave back. Some of my reporting contributed to political and social changes that brought hope to people I'd otherwise hardly have known existed on the planet. I had plenty of fun, too, some of it suitable for retelling in this book. Journalism as a craft is imperfect, and so are its practitioners. All of us make mistakes. Some of us exaggerate. A few, very few, I insist, lie. We are accused, often with justification, of intentionally disrupting society and of deliberately poking our noses into individuals' privacy. But in an age of increasingly dangerous misinformation, propagandizing, and wholesale lying at the highest level of government, journalism remains the most direct route I know to the truth. Those of us who follow it don't always reach that elusive destination. But there's no other road I would rather have traveled. There is no other work to which I'd rather have devoted my life. It's been a hell of a journey. Chapter 1. Murder in Manila. The skinny kid nearly knocked me over as he darted past the narrow doorway just as I ducked in. He halted, pulled out a bottle of gasoline, touched a lighter to a rag hanging from it, and cranked his arm like a pitcher would. A rifle shot cracked. The boy crumpled to the road, and a crimson rose blossomed on the chest of his yellow t-shirt. The bottle slipped from his hand, jingled across the broken pavement, tapped my shoe, and fizzled out. This kid, who couldn't have been more than 16 or 17 years old, was the first of 11 boys and men I saw shot to death that night. Hundreds were fighting, and losing, a lopsided battle against heavily armed soldiers guarding the palace where Philippines President Ferdinand E. Marcos was hiding. The protesters had spent the day, August 31, 1983, engulfed in a flood of other furious Filipinos accompanying the corpse of Marcos's chief political rival, Benigno Aquino Jr., to a suburban Manila cemetery. They believed that Marcos had ordered Aquino murdered as he stepped down from a plane 10 days earlier, returning home from exile in the United States. They unleashed their outrage loudly and violently. I had trudged with them all day. I shared their belief, but I didn't say so. I'd been trained to withhold my opinions. I was there to cover the story. It was an extraordinary tale of murder and corruption. I would spend the next 3 years investigating the Aquino assassination, and, with two colleagues at the San Jose Mercury News, Marcos's bleeding of the Philippines' national treasury. In the end, Aquino's aggrieved widow overthrew Marcos, and we won a Pulitzer Prize. Here's how it happened. My wife Carol, my three young kids, and I were in San Jose on home leave that summer of 1983. I was chatting with the Merck's managing editor, Jerry Seppos, in his office when the Associated Press printer clattered to life, bells ringing. Seppos tore off a slip of paper and handed me the bulletin. Aquino had been gunned down in Manila. "I'm going," I told Jerry. As I'd done numerous times previously and would do again and again, I left Carol and the children behind and took off for a distant place in turmoil. Ninoy, as Aquino was known among nickname-obsessed Filipinos, was Marcos's most worrisome enemy. Marcos had held him for 8 years in solitary confinement awaiting execution. An inveterately social creature, the isolated Ninoy slipped into depression and, in March 1978, suffered twin heart attacks. Seizing the opportunity to get rid of Aquino without killing him, which would have been unpopular at home and in the United States, Marcos permitted him to fly to Texas for triple bypass surgery. He remained in the States for 3 years, living with his family in Boston and lecturing at Harvard and MIT. He made influential American friends and was, by his own account, content. Then the bug of political ambition bit again. He told friends back in Manila that he was weighing a run against Marcos in the next presidential election. Alarmed, they urged him not to return, that his life would be in serious danger. But after settling to his own satisfaction lingering doubts that unseating Marcos was worth suffering or even dying for, Aquino discarded all caution and left for home. He stopped along the way in several Southeast Asian nations, sounding out leaders on his political plans, seeking their support. On the morning of August 21, 1983, he boarded China Airlines Flight 811 at Taipei's Chiang Kai-shek International Airport. A group of foreign correspondents accompanied him on the sparsely occupied Boeing 767, including American and Japanese TV network crews. In what would be the last interview of his life, Aquino dispassionately advised the cameramen to be on their toes once the plane landed. "The action can become very fast," he said. "In a matter of 3 or 4 minutes, it could be all over, you know. I have my bulletproof vest, but if they hit me on the head, there's nothing we can do there." That was exactly how it played out. It was as insane and brutal a moment as could be seen in a Die Hard trailer. Flight 811 landed at 1:03 p.m. and parked at Bay 8 of Manila International's sleekly curved, concrete and tinted glass terminal building. The captain instructed the nervous passengers to remain seated until the boarding party is on board. A jetway was rolled into place, and three men in snug tan army uniforms entered the cabin. On film shot by ABC TV correspondent Jim Laurie's cameraman, which I viewed many times afterward, a man wearing a name tag that identified him as Sergeant Arnulfo de Mesa approached Aquino. They shook hands. "Here," de Mesa said politely. "Please come with me." Aquino bent to pick up a carry-on bag, and, as he did, de Mesa ran a hand along the curve of his back. He could feel the bulletproof vest. Ninoy stood, and another soldier took his bag. A third man approached, and they guided Ninoy toward the front of the plane. The ABC camera caught fleeting shadows of fear and anxiety on his face. He knew. Instead of leaving through the jetway, the soldiers, now six of them, led Ninoy to a narrow steel stairway, normally used by cleaning crews. Dressed in a fresh white safari suit, he was sandwiched front and back between them. Clumsily, they began the steep descent. The soundtrack played back voices screaming in Tagalog. "Here he comes! I'll do it! I'll do it! I'll do it!" Then, in the Cebuano dialect, a single word, "Pusila," shoot. A pistol shot clapped. A high-powered .357 Magnum bullet slammed into the back of Ninoy's head, tore through the soft tissue within, and burst out of his chin. He was dead when his face slammed into the tarmac. Pandemonium. Five shots barked in rapid succession. One or more of them killed a man dressed in the blue coverall of an airport maintenance worker who was standing near the foot of the stairway. A pause of 17 seconds, then another salvo, perhaps 20 rounds, tore into the inert body of the man in blue. A voice, bellowing in Tagalog, "Tamana! Tamana! That's enough!" The next evening, President Marcos went on the air and told Filipinos that the dead man in blue was named Rolando Galman. That was true. He also said the man was a small-time hoodlum. That, too, was true. And he had been hired by the Communist New People's Army to assassinate Aquino. That was a lie. Galman was a stooge, bought off by the army to be present at the airport. Marcos's lie was intended to tamp down rumors already flaring across the Philippines that the army had carried out the killing to protect the ailing president from Aquino's planned challenge. That, I would learn in the course of nearly a year's reporting, was the truth. I hadn't met Ninoy, but while he was in prison and I was with the AP, I had dinner with his wife, Corazon, Cory, at the mansion of mutual friends in Manila's Tony Forbes Park. She was soft-spoken, pleasant, and left no particular impression on me. That would change as I came to know her over the years. Others at the table that evening told tales of an unraveling relationship between the wealthy and powerful Marcos and Aquino families, from friendship and warmth to friction and bitterness. These stories helped inform my understanding of the murder at the airport. On that same visit to Manila, I called on Marcos at his office in the fading Spanish colonial era Malahanyong Palace. He was athletically built, but short, and sensitive about it, and styled his hair in a lofty, early Frank Sinatra pompadour. I realized as we spoke that he was looking down at me. Then I noticed that his desk and leather chair were perched on an elevated platform. Marcos was the undisputed master of a madhouse. In Manila, the national capital and home to 8 million souls, traffic stewed in choking fumes, dragging 15-minute car trips into hours. Motorized tricycles called tuk-tuks sputtered and darted like angry hornets, mocking any notion of road lanes. The most popular form of public transport was the jeepney, a stretched and gussied-up version of the U.S. military vehicle Filipinos had taken to their hearts during World War II. Scrawny children and their scrawnier parents dodged precariously around vehicles, pleading for a few centavos, or flogging newspapers, hard candies by the piece, and cigarettes by the stick. Families slept on broken sidewalks, hundreds in easy view of the U.S. Embassy and the plush Manila Hotel on Manila Bay with its technicolor sunsets. Boys and girls as young as 9 sold their bodies to Japanese and Arab tourists in the Ermita Entertainment District and to American sailors in the Subic Bay Naval Base town of Olongapo. Over the years, each time I returned, I saw the same unfinished buildings, rusted rebar rods clawing like arthritic fingers from raw concrete walls. Manila was a city of thwarted dreams. Appalling poverty had always been the curse of Asian cities such as Calcutta, Bombay, Dhaka, Karachi, and Jakarta. Historically, the Philippines had escaped the worst. Life-sustaining food could be plucked off a tree or snatched from the sea. After the war, the Philippines was considered Southeast Asia's best bet for success. Now, Filipino economists were comparing their nation with Asia's most destitute. They put the blame squarely on the kleptocratic first couple, Ferdinand and Imelda Marcos. Marcos had appointed his wife governor of the capital, a position rife with illicit money-making opportunity. Focused on image, instead of confronting Manila's wretched reality, she cooked up a grandiose but ultimately hollow public relations showcase that she grandly entitled the City of Man. To kick off the project, she commissioned a host of overpriced and underutilized buildings. The Cultural Center of the Philippines, the Metropolitan Folk Arts Theater, the Philippine International Convention Center, the Lung Center of the Philippines, the Philippine Heart Center, and the Kidney Center of the Philippines. Then there was the Coconut Palace, an opulent guest house built specifically to accommodate Pope John Paul II during an official papal visit in 1981. The pontiff refused to stay there, condemning it as offensive in such a poor country. Filipinos, who excel at wordplay, joked that Imelda suffered from an edifice complex. Ninoy mocked the cultural center as a pantheon for Imelda, which instantly was reworked into Imelda's pantheon. The huge expenditure drained already exhausted essential services, such as potable water and electricity for Manila's poor. The pretentious City of Man mutated into the pitiable Sick Man of Asia. Still, most Filipinos accepted corruption as a natural entitlement of the powerful. Why hold public office if not to benefit yourself and your family first? Then Ninoy Aquino was assassinated. The public immediately linked the murder to the first couple. It was the last straw. Ninoy's murder spun the Philippines into a typhoon of turmoil. Over the coming months, and for the next 3 years, thousands, then hundreds of thousands, and ultimately millions of infuriated Filipinos of all social classes swamped the streets, demanding Marcos's removal. Their boisterous, but overall remarkably peaceful demonstrations became known as people power. It succeeded in the Philippines and sparked replicas elsewhere. People power-style rebellions swept through repressed societies around the globe. Outcomes varied in places as far-flung as Tiananmen Square, the Berlin Wall, Russia and other parts of the Soviet Union, South Korea, Indonesia, and the Arab world. Throughout the 3 years between Ninoy's assassination and Marcos's forced departure, I shuttled between Manila and my base in Tokyo. The Manila Hotel, once General Douglas MacArthur's grand residence, became my second home. I spent days marching with throngs of Filipinos dressed in yellow, Cory Aquino's battle color. They gestured with L-shaped thumb and forefinger, symbolizing their support for Laban, meaning fight, Cory Aquino's newly formed party. The reserved Catholic school-educated woman, previously known for little more than being married to Ninoy, metamorphosed into a political force, determined to run for president and to beat Marcos. As I tracked her through Manila's festering streets and across outlying tropical islands, I began to realize that Cory's growing power derived more from image than reality. She and her savvy advisors promoted her as the righteous widow of a beloved martyr. They spun her as pure, honest, pious, almost saintly, overlooking her weaknesses as a brawler in the Philippines' vicious political cockpit. Ordinary citizens, thrashed by 2 decades of Marcosian machismo, felt a salving balm in her serene presence. To comprehend the depth and breadth of the quasi-Shakespearean drama unfolding in the Philippines that mild winter, I found it essential to study the backgrounds of the players. Ferdinand Marcos was born in 1917 in Luzon, the largest and most populous island in the archipelago. Luzon was the economic and political center of the nation, home to Manila, the capital city, and Quezon City, the country's most populous. His parents, Josefa and Mariano, were teachers, and Mariano went on to become a member of Congress. It was a closely held family secret that a wealthy Chinese-Filipino businessman and judge by the name of Ferdinand Chua, whom Marcos called his godfather, was his biological father. The elder Ferdinand supported his namesake progeny, financially, politically, and legally well into adulthood. Chua and the Marcoses helped young Ferdinand hone his competitive, win-at-all-costs nature. He excelled at academics, as well as the macho arts of wrestling, boxing, hunting, survival skills, and marksmanship. Achievement and infamy became Marcos's contradictory trademarks. In 1935, when he was 18, Marcos shot and killed a political opponent of Mariano's with a .22-caliber target pistol. Chua's influence helped him avoid trial for 4 years. By then, he'd graduated from law school. He was found guilty of murder and spent 6 months in jail, during which he wrote his own appeal. Chua bribed the judge handling the case, who dismissed the charge. Marcos returned to court the following day and took the oath, making him an attorney. The Philippines, at the time, was a colony of the United States, which had seized it from Spain in 1898. 10 hours after Japanese aircraft attacked Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, they struck the Philippines. Filipino guerrillas joined American troops in a gruesome 3-year struggle to recapture the country. Marcos emerged from World War II with a spectacular military record, the most decorated Filipino soldier in the U.S. Armed Forces. He was the Audie Murphy of the Philippines. 4 decades later, New York Times reporters Jeff Girth and Joel Brinkley reported that University of Wisconsin historian Alfred W. McCoy had unearthed documents proving that all 33 of Marcos's decorations, among them the Medal of Honor and the Distinguished Service Cross, were fakes. Marcos had awarded them to himself. The U.S. Army dismissed Marcos's claims to them as fraudulent and absurd. Coincidentally, years afterward, my younger daughter Rebecca became one of McCoy's students in Madison, and, in an ironic twist, McCoy, as in the real McCoy, was the most commonly used of Marcos's several nicknames. One prominent American who bought into the Marcos myth was Ronald Reagan, who, coincidentally perhaps, nurtured his own daydream of a heroic wartime career. One of his aides told my friend and colleague Stanley Karnow that in Reagan's wide eyes, Marcos was a hero on a bubblegum card he had collected as a kid. That naive self-deception paid handsome dividends to Marcos during the Reagan presidency. Until it didn't. Marcos used his fake heroism to catapult himself into the presidency of the independent Philippines in 1965. He remained in office for 21 years, 9 of them under martial law. He had more than 3,200 political opponents murdered or disappeared. Mutilated bodies were dumped in public places to spread fear. Tens of thousands more opponents were jailed and tortured. Imelda shared power with her husband in a conjugal dictatorship. She was a real-life rendering of the Dragon Lady, an alluring, avaricious, Asian femme fatale first portrayed in the Terry and the Pirates comic strip. During my decades in Asia, other women cast from the same mold took their places alongside strong men rulers. Chiang Ching, Mao Zedong's vicious third wife. Madame Ngo Dinh Nhu, the manipulative sister-in-law of South Vietnam's bachelor Prime Minister Ngo Dinh Diem. Indonesian President Suharto's wife, Tien, also known as Madame Tien Percent, for the minimum cut she demanded in government business deals. Like the Qing Dynasty Empress Dowager Cixi, who effectively controlled China in the latter half of the 19th century, some of these women served principally as buffers against their husbands' critics. Others wielded power from behind the thrones occupied by their menfolk. Imelda Marcos sat proudly on her own throne. Imelda married Ferdinand in 1954 when she was 26, and he was a decade older. She was born into the wealthy and devoutly Roman Catholic Romualdez family. But by the time she and Ferdinand met, her branch of the family had fallen on hard times, and she was working as a sales girl in a Manila department store. Those years of financial deprivation instilled in Imelda an insatiable appetite for extravagance, which she never ceased to feed as First Lady. Her shopping sprees in the fashion centers of Europe and the United States were legendary. She would return home on jetliners chartered at government expense, their holds filled with crates of jewelry, antiques, artworks, clothing, and her two greatest indulgences, shoes and black lingerie. Imelda maintained a sense of humor about her acquisitiveness. Strolling through the homes of wealthy friends, admiring their possessions, one of her frequent hostesses told me she would joke, "I'm in mining, you know." When these women dutifully pretended surprise, she would respond, "Yes, that's mine, and that's mine, and that's..." A one-time local beauty queen, Imelda was slender and, at 5'7", the same height as Marcos. Fair-skinned and with a heart-shaped face, she wore her sleek, jet-black hair in a towering bouffant, which, like her husband's pompadour, added height, if not stature. Marcos, in a common-law marriage at the time, was instantly smitten and launched a full-court courtship. His avid pursuit, garnished with flowers, gifts, and hints that one day she could become First Lady of the Philippines, persisted for 10 days. On the 11th, she consented. They were married in secret the next day, and 2 weeks later, in church, Marcos paid off his common-law wife, Carmen Ortega, and their 3 children. They and a 4th child, born shortly after Marcos and Imelda's nuptials, were hidden under the Philippines' huge bundle of smelly political laundry. Ninoy Aquino, like Ferdinand Marcos, was a child prodigy, though from a far wealthier background. His family owned 3 vast haciendas in the heart of Luzon. He was Marcos's junior by 15 years. Both attended the University of the Philippines. As brothers of the elite Upsilon Sigma Phi fraternity, even after their enmity was out in the open, they called each other Broad. Before Marcos swept Imelda off her feet, she and Ninoy briefly were an item. He dumped her, and she never forgave him. As a gangly, big-eared kid of 17, Ninoy fast-talked his way into a to-kill-for assignment covering the Korean War for the Manila Times. He returned home to public acclaim, and President Ramon Magsaysay assigned him the extraordinary mission of negotiating a peace treaty with the communist Huk Balahap. The Huks were a fierce band of guerrillas who'd been staging a bloody rebellion against the Philippines government since World War II. Much as he had talked his way into Korea, the young Ninoy convinced the Huks to surrender. At 22, a hero on 2 fronts, he was elected mayor of his hometown. Ambitious would have been more apt a nickname for Aquino than Ninoy. While others ran toward political goals, he sprinted. By 1972, when Marcos imposed martial law, he had established himself as the president's foremost challenger. Many Filipinos forecast that he soon would replace Marcos. So, it came as no surprise when Marcos had him arrested. A military kangaroo court found him guilty on trumped-up charges of murder, illegal possession of firearms, and subversion, then sentenced him to death by firing squad. Marcos commuted the sentence, but kept him locked up. The contrast between the 2 wives, Cory Aquino and Imelda Marcos, was striking. At one of the occasional suppers she hosted at the Manila Hotel for select foreign correspondents, I was not among the chosen, Imelda gaily brushed off tittle-tattle she pretended was circulating, that she was a hotsy-patootsy. I hadn't heard the gossip. Most likely she cooked it up at the table to draw more attention to herself. Whatever she may have meant, Imelda was a notorious word mangler, in the same league as George W. Bush. She certainly epitomized Filipina glamour. I never saw her in public when she was not expertly made up and coiffed. gowned in a gorgeous butterfly-sleeved terno, fingers bejeweled, long nails lacquered in intricate French designs. When she appeared at rallies for her husband, she dazzled the crowds by serenading them with Tagalog pop tunes. Handing out a few pesos to the poor was another favorite ploy. Corey, by comparison, defined simplicity. Her hair was bobbed. She wore large, school marmish glasses, an inexpensive wristwatch, no other jewelry or makeup, and, apparently, the least fashionable dresses and suits she could find. She referred to herself as a plain housewife, and that's what she looked like. But the appearance was deceptive. Corey came from the Kowanko clan, one of the country's wealthiest lineages. Its great fortune was built on the backs of thousands of peasant laborers who raised sugar and rice at Hacienda Luisita, the family's 15,000-acre estate in Tarlac, the same province Ninoy came from. She'd been a studious girl, valedictorian of her Catholic school class in Manila. When the family moved to the United States in 1946, Corey enrolled in exclusive Catholic girls' schools in Philadelphia and New York, then graduated with a major in French and a minor in mathematics from the College of Mount St. Vincent in the Bronx. She returned to the Philippines in 1953 and studied law before dropping out, as expected of women of her class, to marry Ninoy and raise their five children. These, then, were the players. Like the Capulets and the Montagues, the Marcoses and the Aquinos were destined to clash, and their conflict, like that of Shakespeare's disputatious families, would climax in death. But the real-life tragedy in Manila, unlike the fictional one in 13th-century Verona, would prompt a glorious denouement, and the world, if only for a fleeting moment, would be thrilled. Housewife and mom, though she was, Corey was not a political neophyte. The years with Ninoy had taught her how to play her cards. She was assisted by her large extended family and a coterie of top-tier professionals she hired from around the world. Following the airport assassination, she had Ninoy's body embalmed and displayed in the couple's living room and opened the house to the public. I spent hours there, mingling with mourners, from taxi drivers to wealthy matrons who streamed through the house, pausing to cross themselves at the glass casket. It went on for days and nights, around the clock. The corpse was dressed in the same white safari suit, stiff and blackened with dried blood, that Ninoy was wearing when he was shot. It brought to my mind images of Jackie Kennedy, stunned but composed, still dressed in her blood-stained pink outfit long after JFK had been slain in Dallas. On the 10th day after the killing, the Aquinos had the body placed on a large black flatbed trailer truck. The bloody clothing was changed, and the battered face coated in pancake makeup. At the family's calculated instruction, a mortician had recreated bruises and the bullet hole in the chin. The makeshift hearse was garlanded with wreaths of yellow blossoms, yellow candles, and handwritten yellow signs expressing love and grief. Many in the horde, police estimated more than a million, wore yellow and waved yellow flags and placards. Yellow ribbons were wrapped around power poles and trees. Filipinos, for half a century torn between love for American culture and hatred for U.S. political intervention, had chosen a 1973 American pop hit, Tie a Yellow Ribbon Round the Old Oak Tree, to express their sorrow. As I inched with the cortege past tall buildings, office workers showered us with confetti of shredded telephone yellow pages. This was the first time the color blanketed the streets of Manila as a symbol of support for the Aquinos and opposition to the Marcos regime. From then on, Corey was rarely seen in public wearing any other color. For 11 hours and over 19 miles, I plodded with the mourners alongside the truck to Manila Memorial Park on the southern edge of the city. Thunder showers and broiling sun alternately drenched us and steamed us dry. 31-year-old Jesus Gueco, who had driven from his and Ninoy's hometown the night before, told me he was hopeful the tragedy would lead to a change for the better. I think that what happened to Ninoy will finally unite us, all Filipinos, in a common cause, he said. Things won't be like they were before, where people don't mind what's done to them. This is like awakening from a deep sleep. Dream on, Jesus, I said to myself. I was writing my account for the Mercury News the night of the funeral procession when my hotel room phone rang. It was Abby Tan, my stringer. A native Singaporean, Abby had lived in Manila for years, working as a freelance journalist. She knew everyone, and everyone knew her. I couldn't have managed without her. Several hundred men and boys have seized Mendiola Bridge, she told me. Mendiola was a narrow span leading to Malahanyang Palace. They're fighting soldiers and police. Let's go, I said. Abby picked me up in her Japanese compact. We rushed across town and huddled in a dark doorway as the ragtag band threw rocks and Molotov cocktails. The troops repulsed them with water cannon, beat them with truncheons, and shot them with rifles. It was at this point that the youngster who was about to toss a Molotov cocktail at Marcos's defenders, in firing positions behind coils of razor wire, fell dead at my feet. 18 others, suffering gunshot wounds, were bundled into a lineup of ambulances, screaming klaxons piercing the din of the battle. Just when it seemed Manila was about to descend into unprecedented bedlam, history briefly switched course. As Ninoy's corpse was being trundled through the streets, a Soviet fighter jet shot down a Korean Airlines jumbo jet south of Russia's Sakhalin Island. All 269 people aboard were killed. One of the victims was the daughter of friends in Tokyo. I left for Seoul to cover the story. The shift in international attention gave the beleaguered Marcos a moment to regain energy and marshal his forces. The fact that the KAL flight was number 007 was not lost on many Filipinos. Seven was Marcos's lucky number. In Washington, the Reagan administration stood by and waited apprehensively. The president publicly backed Marcos, but worried in private about his chances of surviving the Aquino onslaught. Reagan worried, justifiably, that whoever might replace Marcos could terminate the leases on Clark Air Base and Subic Bay Naval Base. Both were considered irreplaceable for U.S. force projection in the Pacific. A further complication was the close personal friendship between the Reagans and the Marcoses. Over the coming months, angry anti-Marcos demonstrations became a regular feature of life in the Philippines. Shuttling every few weeks from Tokyo to Manila, I spent days and nights among infuriated Filipinos deliberately provoking police, and police firing at the hecklers. Reporters became targets of both sides, and I often had to duck behind buildings and into alleys to avoid being shot or stoned. During breaks from covering the action in the streets, I worked at developing a list of sources, including military officers, politicians, lawyers, and business people. In October, 2 months after the assassination, Marcos appointed a fact-finding panel to investigate what he sanctimoniously called the National Tragedy and National Shame. One of my newfound contacts was among the five members. The panel spent 9 months investigating evidence and conducting hearings. Members heard sworn testimony from dozens of witnesses, from Imelda Marcos and Army Chief of Staff General Fabian Ver, to the enlisted men who had accompanied Ninoy down the gangplank, and a hospitality girl who serviced Rolando Galman, the alleged gunman. Painstakingly, the board members amassed tens of thousands of pages of documents and hundreds of photographs, videos, and audio tapes. Then they went into seclusion. Where was a well-kept secret? In the evenings, correspondents gathered in the Manila Hotel's cushy lobby lounge. Over San Miguel beers and gratis tabacalera cigars dipped in brandy by a genial waitress, we exchanged guesses as to where the board was holed up. Early one morning, about a month and a half after they disappeared from view, and as public doubt grew that they would produce a just finding, I succumbed to frustration and half-heartedly telephoned my contact's office. The person who answered gave me another number. I dialed it. "Philippine Village," a switchboard operator answered brightly. Bingo. The board was at this government-owned hotel and casino a stone's throw from the airport where Ninoy had been murdered. That was the first surprise. The second was when the operator put me through to the name I asked for, and he picked up. A third surprise came when he proposed dinner that evening. I spent the next hours pacing my room and preparing questions. We met at the restaurant he recommended. A large, dimly lit place lined in dark mahogany and burgundy velvet. We were the only diners. We ordered martinis and steaks. "How are things going at Philippine Village?" I asked for openers. "You're not supposed to know about that," he laughed. He told me they were meeting day and night in the suite of their leader, Corazon Juliano Agrava, a retired children's court judge and the sole woman on the panel. At 69, Rosie Agrava enjoyed wearing above-the-knee skirts to display her chorus girl legs. She insisted the board not spend public funds on room service, and the air was growing heavy with the rich smells of adobo cooking in her suite's kitchen. My source, normally an impeccable dresser, had swapped suit and tie for a red polo, khakis, and sockless loafers. He'd stopped shaving and seemed to be suffering from cabin fever. Our steaks arrived, and we ordered another round of martinis. He was relaxing. I hadn't expected to learn much. I was wrong. He started out with a bang. The board had concluded that the military was lying. Rolando Galman had not killed Aquino. This, in itself, was major news. But he went on. At the time Ninoy had announced his plans to return home, Marcos, unknown to the public, was gravely ill with lupus. The disease led to kidney failure. He had secretly undergone 2 transplants and was on regular dialysis treatment in a windowless, hospital-style room in the presidential palace. Those closest to him, especially Imelda and Eduardo Coanco Jr., the president's intimate friend and advisor, believed he was near death. Coanco, who had capitalized on his friendship with Marcos to build a huge, largely illicit fortune, was Cory Aquino's first cousin. He, like Imelda, enjoyed direct access to General Vair and his top commanders. So firm was the bond that they didn't need to order or even ask Vair to have the army assassinate Ninoy. They simply let drop circuitous comments. As I listened raptly and took notes, my mind flashed on the tale of King Henry II and his nemesis, Thomas a Becket, the Archbishop of Canterbury. "Will no one rid me of this turbulent priest?" a frustrated Henry raged at his courtiers. While not expressed as an order, it prompted 4 knights anxious to prove fealty to their monarch to murder Thomas. My contact and I stared at each other across the table, and I said he seemed to be telling me that he and his colleagues had determined who had ordered Aquino killed. But he was enjoying himself and didn't want to rush the narrative. Overriding my remark, he said they had determined that Marcos himself was too sick to be directly involved. Rather, the guilty party was, like Henry's knights, someone eager to please the boss. Then he shifted course and turned to personal matters. What it had been like for him and his associates to be subjected to public scrutiny and abuse. How it had affected their families. "It's been an honest job," he said. "We don't want to embarrass our grandchildren." "Well," I said, "that really leaves just one question unanswered." He took a deep breath and exhaled. "It's Vair. Everyone else was responsible to him." And that was that. I paid the check and we left the restaurant together. I thanked him for his help. As we shook hands on the deserted street, he said, almost as a postscript, "I think you'd better not single me out." I haven't. Until now. But my source has since died, and any number of my colleagues and interested Filipinos guessed that he was Dante G. Santos, the highly respected president of Filacor, the country's largest maker of refrigerators and freezers. They were right. R.I.P. Dante. I was uncomfortable relying on a single source, particularly for such an explosive story, and I knew that expecting a second board member to come out of the closet was out of the question. I dealt with Santos before and found him to be reliable. Besides, he didn't come looking for me. I tracked him down. I believe that once I had presented him with the opportunity, he broke his vow of silence and spoke to me because he worried that Agrava and Marcos would succeed in burying the truth. I decided it was unwise to file from Manila. I flew home to Tokyo and sent the story from our kitchen table. It began. The commission investigating the 1983 murder of Philippine opposition leader Benigno S. Aquino Jr. will accuse the chief of the nation's armed forces of ordering the killing, according to a member of the panel. In an exhaustive report planned for release within the next 2 weeks, the commission will charge that Armed Forces Chief of Staff General Fabian Ver headed a conspiracy to gun down Aquino as he was led off a plane at Manila International Airport, said the panel member, who insisted on anonymity. I noted that the board's report would not name the brains behind the plot, Eduardo Coanco Jr., but would refer to him as an ambitious, troublesome individual who had his own plans to become president. The board, I wrote, had concluded that a military security guard, not Rolando Galman, had pulled the trigger. And, to keep the record clear, I added, the report will in no way implicate Marcos or his wife Imelda in the plot to murder Aquino or in the subsequent cover-up, the source emphasized. The Mercury News took the unusual step of copywriting the story and spread it across the top of the front page on Sunday, August 26, 1984. Other papers in the Knight Ridder chain, which owned the Merc and subscribers to its news service, played it prominently. Wire services relayed it back to Manila, where government-controlled papers withheld it. But the story made a huge splash in the city's influential alternative press. All five board members issued statements denying being my source. Curiously, their denials, absent the story, were carried in the controlled papers, which rebuked the Merc and me. The cat was out of the bag. That was where my source wanted it to be, and I was pleased to help put it there. Every reporter loves an exclusive. Nothing quite matches the kick of breaking a story that's yours alone. But there is such a thing as being too exclusive, too alone for too long. My piece had stated that the commission would release its report by mid-September. It didn't. Weeks dragged by, and I began to feel in the pit of my stomach cold fear that I'd been used. I had been. But I tried to convince myself that my reporting heightened expectations among Filipinos, virtually all of whom suspected that Ver had ordered the assassination and who would have been maddened if he were not accused. And it helped break a logjam at Philippine Village. An acrimonious struggle broke out in Rosie Agrava's suite. The four men were at her throat, and she at theirs. She was unwilling to implicate Ver. Marcos had gotten to her. Dante Santos had told me over our steak and martini dinner that Marcos's chief legal advisor, Manuel Lazaro, had secretly brought Agrava to the palace on three separate occasions. Marcos convinced her that accusing the leader of the nation's armed forces of murder would lead to mutiny and tear the country apart. Midday on Tuesday, October 23rd, 7 weeks after my piece was published and 14 months after the murder, Agrava appeared on live television alongside Marcos in the ceremonial hall of Malacanang. He wore an elaborately embroidered barong Tagalog, the translucent shirt crafted from pineapple leaf fiber that is the national dress for men. She was in a trim olive-green dress, almost military in appearance. She handed him a 121-page book entitled Separate Report of the Chairman. It placed all blame for the murder on the 6 enlisted men who'd been on the gangway and their boss, Brigadier General Luther Custodio. General Vare was not a plotter, Agrava's report concluded. Marcos thanked her warmly. Filipinos went to bed that night embittered, believing that the elaborate investigation and hearings had been a cover-up after all, a ruse as they had anticipated, and that my story had been false. I didn't sleep well either. But the next morning, the 4 male board members delivered their own report to the palace. Marcos let them cool their heels for an hour before grudgingly accepting their 2 weighty volumes. They cited as indictable for the premeditated murder of Aquino, 26 men, all but 1 military enlistees and officers. General Vare's name was at the top of the list. There was no live TV. A brief clip on the evening news showed Marcos fixing the board members with a cold glare and admonishing them, "I hope you can live with your conscience, with what you have done." What they had done, in fact, was to push Marcos a giant step closer to the cliff's edge. Their findings revived public confidence. It also alarmed a number of mid-ranking military officers. Sensing imminent danger to their institution and themselves, these captains, majors, and colonels banded together. They named themselves the Reform the Armed Forces Movement, RAM. RAM quickly accumulated 1,500 members and drew vital support from 2 unlikely father figures. One was Lieutenant General Fidel Ramos, a cigar-chomping West Point graduate. The other, Juan Ponce Enrile, was a polished Harvard Law School-trained attorney. Though neither knew it then, they eventually would determine the future of the country. Eddie Ramos was the Army's second-in-command, and Johnny Enrile was the nation's defense minister. Both were long-time, dyed-in-the-wool Marcos loyalists and beneficiaries, but they had personal axes to grind, too. Ramos was irate that Marcos had bypassed him and promoted the slavishly obedient Vare, who had been a police officer in Marcos's hometown, to the top military job. Enrile had envisaged himself succeeding Marcos. As they watched the president's house of cards begin to shake, they realized they soon would have to make difficult decisions. No one in RAM, not Ramos nor Enrile, had been particularly upset by Ninoy's assassination. The armed forces had benefited enormously from Marcos's patronage. He had imposed martial law, encouraged them to abuse innocent civilians as they saw fit, quintupled their strength, and made the generals rich. Marcos recast the Philippines military, once an apolitical organization based on the U.S. model, into his personal bodyguard. Most soldiers were fine with that, but now, as they saw Vare, and by extension Marcos, in the crosshairs of justice, they realized the future of the armed forces and the country itself was in jeopardy. Their own reputations and careers were on the line. Fearful, they began meeting and plotting. Joan Orendine, a public relations executive and dear friend, who, like Abby Tan, seemed to know everyone, introduced me to several RAM officers. Joan and Abby once had been rivals for the same boyfriend, which required me to keep my relationships with them separate and distinct. The RAM guys and I began meeting for drinks and meals, and they kept me abreast of their thinking. Rumors of a coup were making the rounds. It was about this time that technology impacted my professional life in a huge way. The Merc shipped me my first portable word processor, a Radio Shack TRS-80 Model 100. Known affectionately to enthusiasts as the Trash 80, it was about the size and weight of a science textbook and ran on 4 penlight batteries. Its tiny, yellowish screen displayed a half dozen lines of pixelized letters. Most important to me, it could transmit over phone lines pretty much anywhere. Every once in a while, an event or a thing comes along and proves to be a game changer. The Trash 80 was, for me, a life changer. After writing a story on it, I simply had to attach it to my hotel room's telephone, tap a few keys, buzz, buzz, screech, and off the copy went, straight to the foreign desk at the Merc, 7,000 miles away, in almost real time. To convey some sense of how remarkable this new technology was for me, it was only a few years since I'd squatted on the dirt floor of a telegraph office in Pondicherry, India, alongside a barefoot Morse code operator as he dotted and dashed my story to the Washington Post. Now, I no longer had to bribe and cajole telex operators. I no longer had to run to the nearest AP or Reuters office at ungodly hours. Free at last. Well, sort of. The ability to attach the hard rubber acoustic coupler to the phone was a sometime thing. Depending on the country and the hotel, handsets varied in size and shape. The coupler, which resembled a pair of earmuffs, might or might not fit. At the Manila hotel, the stylish desk phone handsets were squared off. The round earmuffs couldn't be forced to stay on. An extension phone on the bathroom wall above the toilet bowl provided a much better fit. So, when I was ready to hit send, I placed my little miracle on the toilet lid, jammed the coupler onto the phone, and voila. Or not. To make sure all went well, I knelt in front of the commode, monitoring the sluggishly moving type, and frequently repeated the whole process. Sometimes I would be there for hours, knees numb, sending and resending. As I knelt and more or less prayed that my copy would go through, I daydreamed that if a Vesuvius-grade volcano were to erupt at that moment and my remains were discovered a millennium or two in the future, archaeologists doubtless would conclude that I had belonged to a primordial cult and was performing a mysterious rite that involved crude electronics and a porcelain water vessel when I was fossilized. For the record, Mount Pinatubo, 60 miles from Manila, did blow its top in 1991. It was the world's greatest volcanic eruption in a century. The trash 80 and I were elsewhere at the time. When not beseeching the tech gods, I could be found at morning coffee clutches with members of Manila's notorious chattering classes. Filipinos love nothing more than exchanging chismes, Tagalog for gossip, and one topic was common currency. Everyone seemed to have a story they wanted to share about a piece of prime real estate or a stash of gold or a numbered Swiss account belonging to the Marcoses or someone in their innermost circle, cronies, as they were known. During a breakfast session at the ritzy Mandarin Hotel, a banker asked me if I knew how much Imelda had paid for the Crown Building in Midtown Manhattan. I often had walked past this splendid Art Deco skyscraper, topped with a gold spire on Fifth Avenue. Designed by the same team of architects as Grand Central Station, it was listed as one of the most expensive commercial buildings in the United States. I had no idea who owned it. The banker's verbatim question was simply, "How much did she pay?" Just that. I understood there was only one she in the Philippines, just as there was one he. But my new acquaintance could see from my blank expression that I didn't know what he was talking about. That surprised him. "Surely you know that she owns the Crown Building?" When I admitted I didn't, he fixed me with a "you know," raising eyebrows and wrinkling forehead in a classic Filipino gesture, vaguely akin to Indian head wobbling. "Everyone," he said, "knew the First Lady bought the classic structure. She had it magnificently refurbished, paying particular attention to disassembling and reassembling the gleaming black marble lobby and re-gilding the 23-carat crown." A few days later, I went to see Reverend James Donnellan, a friend of many years, and, over coffee, told him what I'd heard. "Oh, sure," he said nonchalantly. Then he mentioned that Imelda also owned Lindenmere, a multi-million-dollar estate on Long Island. Father Jim was in a position to know. A brilliant, Oxford-educated American Jesuit, he'd lived and worked in the Philippines for decades. He founded the Asian Institute of Management, which trained many of the nation's leading business executives, and was president of the prestigious Ateneo de Manila University. And he was Imelda's confessor. I didn't ask, and Jim didn't offer, whether he was breaking the inviolable sacramental seal by telling me about the Long Island estate. I assume not, but that was between Jim and his God. As I made my rounds of Manila's gossip mongers, I grew increasingly impressed by the broad range of people who had similar information and were happy to share it. They included multi-million-dollar landowners and owners of little sari-sari stores, taxi drivers and university professors, waitresses and students, and of course, politicians. They ticked off properties and investments in New York, California, Texas, Washington, D.C., Washington State, Canada, Australia, Latin America, and Europe. How could this be, I wondered. How could so many know so much? Then the penny dropped. They didn't. No one actually knew anything. It was all chismes, gossip, rumor. No one had seriously investigated. I wanted to try. I wrote a lengthy memo to Jonathan Krim, the foreign editor in San Jose. The highlight was a list of every piece of real estate I'd heard that the Marcoses and their cronies owned outside the Philippines. Many were in the Merck's backyard, Silicon Valley, and the San Francisco Bay Area. I went into considerable detail about dollar salting, the practice by rich and well-connected Filipinos of siphoning money out of the country and hiding it abroad. Filipinos were banned by law from transferring hard currency, even if it was earned in legal business dealings. Stealing it from the national treasury was, of course, a major crime. Both were done with alarming frequency. Moving the money was simple. In one case, a woman bound for Hong Kong was arrested at the Manila airport in 1981 with $1 million neatly packed in two suitcases. She'd made 33 similar trips over the previous 18 months. Slightly more sophisticated were wire transmissions funneled through shadowy moneylenders in Manila's Chinatown. I had discussed dollar salting with Bill Sullivan, whom I'd first met while he was the U.S. ambassador to Laos and later Iran. He'd also once headed the embassy in Manila. The drain, Sullivan told me, had damaged the Philippines' economy more severely than Iran had been hurt by the same process before Shah Reza Pahlavi was overthrown. Over $10 billion had been sucked out of the country in recent years, according to Bernardo Villegas, one of the Philippines' leading economists. His colleague, Jesus Estanislao, put the figure at $30 billion. Coincidentally, perhaps, the nation's foreign debt then was nearly $30 billion. I proposed to Krim that I take a serious look at the dollar salting, with a focus on the California properties. He was the most perceptive, most caring editor for whom I ever worked, and he was intrigued. But he also foresaw the difficulties and the practical considerations. I conceded up front that what I'd collected so far was speculation, that I had nothing yet that necessarily would prove out, that there might not be any criminal wrongdoing, that such an in-depth investigation would require a major commitment of time and money, and that the chance of success was slim. Ever since the Aquino murder, the Merck had devoted considerably more space to developments in the Philippines than most other U.S. papers had. When I broke the story of General Ver's guilt, members of San Jose's substantial Filipino-American community responded with enthusiasm. Some came forward with new information, fueling more stories. So there was reason to believe that the investigation I was proposing would generate major interest and attract additional local help. Krim discussed the idea with the paper's two top editors, Jerry Sepos and Bob Engel. Hesitantly, they gave the project a green light. This dubious beginning would give rise to a journalistic investigation that would help end a corrupt 20-year-long dictatorship. Like Ida Tarbell's Standard Oil muckraking in 1902, Upton Sinclair's expose of Chicago's meatpacking plants 4 years later, and Seymour Hersh's 1969 uncovering of the My Lai massacre, it changed history and lives. Stories like these are what makes a free press priceless. Jonathan and I agreed that he would pass my list to Pete Carey, the paper's chief investigative reporter. "Look into this," Krim said. Pete, ostensibly a laid-back native Californian, was in reality a driven obsessive, as a world-class investigator must be. He had been covering Silicon Valley since its pioneering days and was an innovator in the emerging field of computerized data mining at a time when most investigative journalists still relied on shoe leather, door knocking, and phone calls. Pete went to work with a short-lived online database being beta-tested by a company called Real Estate Data Incorporated. He used it to confirm buyers' identities, prices, and purchase dates of the California properties. Bay Area Filipinos helped him fill in some blanks. Imelda's extensive and expensive holdings in New York required more time-proven techniques. Pete flew to Manhattan, where he researched government records, located and questioned sources who didn't want to be found, dug up an obscure lawsuit filed against Imelda in Long Island, and discovered New York Land Company, a small law firm that managed her secret commercial real estate investments in the city. Owned by Joseph and Ralph Bernstein, American brothers who had grown up in the Philippines, the firm was located on 57th Street off 5th Avenue, spitting distance of the Crown Building. Pete later told me this delightful story. When I first visited New York Land's office, I noticed one of those velvet boards you put letters in to make words. It was dusty, but there on that board was the name of every shell company I had just looked up at the recorder's office. 40 Wall Street, Herald Center, the Crown Building, Lindemere, etc., along with the names of current and, I suspected correctly, former employees. A burly security guard behind the desk eyed me skeptically, and when I proceeded to write down all those names, he said, "I'm supposed to tell you not to do that." And I said cheerfully, "And I'm supposed to do it." He grunted, "Okay," and I continued to scribble in my notebook. Joe Bernstein refused to meet me, though I managed to talk to him on his home phone later. He denied everything, of course. The Marcoses and their cronies had taken great pains to hide their ownership beneath layers of dummy corporations and false fronts. But Pete's sources led him to believe that the stories could be documented, if one knew where to look. With Pete in the United States and me in the Philippines, we spent 6 months tapping scores of government officials, politicians, attorneys, real estate agents, bankers, diplomats, and other knowledgeable people. Once our editors were convinced the investigation stood a strong chance of producing results, they added San Francisco correspondent Catherine Ellison to our little team. Kathy was young, talented, ambitious, and hungry. Armed with ample chutzpah and proven data, she became the project's door knocker in chief, confronting property owners face to face with our findings. Early one Sunday morning, Kathy showed up at the San Francisco residence of Nemesio Yabut, the mayor of Makati, the Manila business district. His honor came to the door in his jammies. Kathy told Yabut we knew he had paid $520,000 for the pink stucco residence in St. Francis Woods, an exclusive enclave near Golden Gate Park. That was real money in the Bay Area housing market back in the day. Kathy also told Yabut she had learned he owned a $900,000 apartment, at least two condominiums, and a seafood restaurant, the old Clam House, all in San Francisco. Presented with these facts, Yabut denied nothing. Rather, he assured Kathy that he unfailingly paid his U.S. taxes. "I remember the story of Al Capone," he told her, with no apparent sense of irony. "Al Capone was never convicted of anything but tax evasion." Yabut was a piker in comparison with the Marcoses and some of their other cronies. We learned that Imelda paid $51 million for the Crown Building and another $15 million on upgrades, including 103,063 ounces of 23-karat gold leaf. Title was assigned to a Netherlands Antilles shell. She spent another $46 million to tear down and rebuild a 10-story glass-encased shopping mall in Manhattan's Herald Square. She named it Herald Center. It quickly deteriorated into a white elephant. Yet another of her landmark Manhattan properties was the green copper-peaked skyscraper at 40 Wall Street. Donald Trump subsequently bought it and named it after himself. curious how people like the Trumps and Marcoses so often wind up in bed together, or, as in this case, the same bed at different times. In Manila, I went through front and back channels, seeking an interview with the Marcoses about their holdings. They ignored me, so I sent them a registered letter. Would they confirm that they owned the above-named properties and that they did business through the Bernstein brothers and several other front men and women I named? And what were their views on Filipinos salting dollars abroad at a time when the economy is in such dire straits? To my astonishment, an aide to the president telephoned me and read out a denial that the couple owned any property in the United States. Incongruously, he then recited, "So long as the acquisitions are legal, nobody can question the owner's right to these properties." When I questioned the disconnect, he said the matter was not addressed in my letter. Otherwise, while Pete and Kathy were tilling rich soil in the United States, I was scratching dry Philippines sand. As expected, little documentation could be uncovered in the country. Still, tucked away in the chismis were sources whom, when I approached them with patience and assurances of anonymity, agreed to talk. Anyone listening in on my phone calls from the Manila hotel or tracing my tuk-tuk journeys around town would have had a clear idea of what I was up to. I'd seen no sign I was being monitored, but the hotel doorman thought otherwise. Just after sunrise each morning, before the sticky heat grew too oppressive, I would greet him and set off on a run to clear my head and prepare for the day ahead. My route took me atop the broad stone seawall holding back Manila Bay from the traffic and beggars of tree-lined Rojas Boulevard. After some weeks of this routine, I returned to the hotel one morning, drenched in sweat as usual, and the white-uniformed doorman hissed me aside.
"Mr. Simons, be careful,"
he whispered as we faced each other behind a corner of the whitewashed building.
"Why?" "They're watching you."
"Who?" He hoisted his eyebrows, twice in quick succession, then pulled open the heavy, narrow wood door. If I was under surveillance, I, A, hadn't seen any sign of it, and B, didn't have many options. I had to rely on my room phone and travel by tuk-tuk or taxi. I did adjust my morning run, though, and now trotted along the sun-dappled sidewalk, in clear view of traffic and pedestrians, rather than on the shaded, hidden seawall. In the end, Pete, Kathy, and I were able to confirm much of the chismes. We spent several weeks writing, with Jonathan meticulously editing the complex material. The project had taken us a year. The result was a 3-day series of articles that the Merc began publishing on June 23, 1985. It was titled Hidden Billions, The Draining of the Philippines. It opened with this. As the Philippines sinks deeper into a quagmire of poverty, foreign debt, and political unrest, many of its most prominent citizens are systematically draining vast amounts of wealth from their nation and hiding it overseas. Investigative journalism lives or dies on details. We had plenty. We named 10 people. Ferdinand and Imelda Marcos were the principals. The cronies we singled out included cabinet ministers, senior civil servants, politicians, and intimate friends of the first couple. We identified their properties, many of which Pete and Kathy had visited. We unearthed contracts that showed what they had paid for them. We peeled back layers of camouflage to learn how they'd managed to keep deals hidden for years. All had cleverly hidden their investments, often putting them in the hands of seemingly casual acquaintances or small fry employees with little to recommend their being entrusted with millions of dollars. A commonly used scheme was the use of these people's names in offshore holding companies in Caribbean tax havens. We tracked down these surrogates, questioned them, and reported their responses, mostly denials. Many arrangements were based on utang na loob, a traditional Filipino cultural arrangement meaning blood debt or obligation. Under this system, a person is eternally indebted to whoever helped her or him reach a goal. So, when Imelda Marcos promoted Vilma Bautista, a member of her staff in Manila, to a coveted posting at the Philippines' United Nations mission in Manhattan, Bautista understood she would be under the First Lady's thumb for the rest of her life. When Imelda then asked her to sign millions of dollars worth of checks for real estate deals, she did so unhesitatingly, never admitting that it was the First Lady, not she, who owned the buildings. Shortly after our series broke and the Marcoses were on the ropes, Bautista, apparently sensing the jig was up, threw in the utang na loob towel and poured her blood debt down the drain. She stole four valuable paintings from a Marcos townhouse in Manhattan, then sold one, Claude Monet's famed impressionist Water Lily Pond, for $32 million. Piling audacity upon criminality, she paid no taxes on the sale, as she hadn't on her other income, legitimate and otherwise, for decades. In 2020, New York State found Vilma guilty of evading $14,281,977.75 in taxes, ranking her the second greatest tax dodger in the state, and jailed her for 2 years. Utang na loob and numerous other under-the-table arrangements were designed like mazes to lure trackers down blind alleys and into dead ends. New York Democratic Congressman Stephen Solars tried and failed to navigate the labyrinth. Even with the assistance of State Department experts, Solars was unable to solve the puzzle. Our series alarmed the Reagan administration and shook Congress. The heaviest impact was felt, of course, in Manila. Newspapers there dodged official punishment by publishing the articles and then, tongue-in-cheek, belittling them. In these reprints, hidden billions evolved into hidden wealth, which was enshrined in the indigenous lexicon. Saying those two words to a Filipino today evokes much the same reaction as Watergate does with an American. Filipinos were electrified. That an American newspaper had presented them with documented facts, where previously there was only chismis, added to the story's authenticity. Among the sadder effects of centuries-long Spanish and then American bastardization of their culture was Filipinos' dependence on the United States for back-patting and wrist-slapping. But because the stories had originated in the San Jose Mercury News and not, say, the New York Times or Washington Post, Marcos believed he could ride out the storm. "These are the findings of a small regional newspaper in California," Marcos's loyal labor minister, Blas Oble, snickered to local journalists. "He can overcome this." Oble wasn't terribly far off in describing the murk, but he was dead wrong about the outcome. Opposition leaders seized on our stories and demanded Marcos be impeached. That didn't happen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.